welcome to another episode of Frightfully Forgotten's Trash or Treasure. But before we get started, what are we drinking?
Today we are drinking Lords of Death Hopped Rice Lager.
Today we're going to bring to you 1988's Dead Heat, directed by Mark Goldblatt. And
Goldblatt.
He directed The Punisher with Dolph Lundgren.
Oh, yeah.
That's right, baby. He was the editor in tons of Wicked movies.
Oh, yeah.
The Howling, Halloween 2, and then Terminator 1 and 2.
Yeah.
Like, fuck.
Tons of stuff. Tons of Schwarzenegger movies.
Yeah, Commando and everything.
It stars Treat Williams. What kind of name is that? Treat.
Maybe it's supposed to be Tret.
Tret? That makes sense. With some woman, she's like, oh, treat!
You're a real treat.
He was in tons and tons of stuff, but we really want to mention that he is uncredited as a jogger in The Marathon Man.
Fucking right. Is it safe?
Joe Piscopo is in this, and he was in SNL for a good 4 years during the 80s. And he was also in one of the best martial arts movies of all time, with Chuck Norris, Sidekicks. Yeah. Chuck Norris kicks him, he's all, whoa, 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 he's all spinning, ooh, ooh. Lindsay Frost is also in this, and she is in one abysmal piece of shit horror movie called The Ring.
Ugh. The movie starts off with partners Roger Mortis and Doug Bigelow, and they're called to this jewelry heist, and they show the two thief guys, and they're all wearing like those...
Is it S&M? Yeah. Executioner?
But they get to the jewelry store, they start smashing all the cases and everything, and start intimidating all the people who work there. Come on, lady, give it up!
You cheap bitch!
Cheap bitch! Pulls the like almost the whole damn police force. And who's in charge but Robert Picardo, who's the hologram doctor in Voyager.
He's also in The Howling.
Yeah, that's right. And they have a huge shootout, start shooting the shit out of these guys. They blow one of them up. Roger kind of gets pissed off and he gets in a car. He ends up just running right into another one. The woman at the morgue, she's like, well, these guys, they've already been here. These guys have already been sewn up. What made them come to life? So it's a drug that Dante Pharmaceuticals has created.
So Doug and Roger go to check out the Dante Pharmaceuticals. They get introduced to Randy James, who kind of like oversees the running of this place, and she shows them around and shows them the decompression chamber. Doug kind of stumbles upon this room where there's this carcass, unveils it, and it's this weird biker-looking guy with like three faces kind of all melted together, and he starts fighting this biker guy, beating the shit out of him with this, like, fire extinguisher. Bung! Bung! Roger, like, he just shoots the front desk guy. And he gets thrown into that decompression chamber and accidentally the button gets pressed and he dies. The cops and Rebecca show up to the scene to find out that Roger is now dead. While investigating, they stumble upon this weird machine, and she's kind of looking into it. And of course, there's a phone on the console.
Yeah.
That's how 80s it is. Every console has a phone on it.
And she knows how to work it,
too. She knows how to work it.
Yeah.
Oh, this machine resurrects the dead. And just throw Roger on this machine, and they bring him back to life. He's still decomposing, and in 12 hours, he will be decomposed and no longer alive. So they have 12 hours to find out who's behind these robberies and who has created this resurrection machine.
Right, and what's it all about.
Yeah, kind of how it all ties in together.
Okay, so to get to the bad of this movie, right?
The trash.
The characters in this movie, even though you may think that they're pretty strong, they're actually not. They're pretty weak.
Yeah, they're not really fleshed out very well. There's just basically Roger and Doug. They're not even that different, really.
No, and they don't play off each other as well as they could.
Yeah.
Like, there's a lot of one-liners that don't seem to really land all that well.
Especially on Joe Piscopo's part. Most of his one-liners are just like, oh. You're just like, Was that supposed to be funny, or is that supposed to be bad? Like, you don't really know.
Yeah, I like.
But you should know.
I know it's a joke, but it's just not all that funny. And there's also a lot of dead air, like, between them that could be filled with more stuff.
More interaction between Doug and Roger, I think, because, like, yeah, like, when Roger dies and Doug's in that chair and he's all depressed, like, yeah, you kind of feel it, but there wasn't enough there before to really make you kind of feel like, that's shitty that, you know, that he's dead. Like, you don't really care.
Exactly, know? Yeah.
This movie is just fucking chocked full of plot holes all over the place. Like, everything about this movie is one giant plot hole, really.
Yeah.
So Roger's dead, and they find a resurrection machine, which brings him back to life, and nobody really seems to, like, care or really dig into, like, where did this machine come from, or, like, why is this here? And like,
or wow.
Like, and this big shootout happened at this place where there's this resurrection machine. And like afterwards, people are just walking by. Like, there's nothing happening. And no one seems to care that shit just went down. Like, holy fuck. Randy, she just gets away. Like, they have to chase her down later. Like, she should have never left the fucking building.
Right. There's also a lack of a score or music.
Yeah, which is strange for an 80s movie.
Yeah, and it sort of, you can feel the hole that it leaves, right?
Like, every time they start the car, that fucking sweet-ass car, they should be...
Right, exactly, and they should just fucking cruise. Yeah. But they don't, and it sort of leaves you wanting so much more.
But at the end of the movie, the credits, there's that Dead Heat song, which is like, oh yeah, that's pretty good. Like, why wasn't that in the movie?
Exactly, you know? They should have played throughout the entire thing, right, as the theme.
Yeah, exactly. Why the fuck wasn't that in the movie?
I don't know.
Oh, Christ.
All right, and that'll bring us to the treasure of this movie.
The effects.
Oh, yeah.
They look great. Like, that first zombie you see, the biker zombie with the three faces. Oh, man. I was like, holy shit, that's a fucking zombie. He looked great.
Also, there's that scene where they go to that butcher shop. The guy who owns the butcher shop, he, like, pulls that lever, and there's all that lightning and everything that starts making everything come to life.
That mini resurrection machine on the ceiling.
Yeah, and, like, all the chickens and everything start moving, and...
like, everything.
Yeah, every fucking
carcass,
thing.
Yeah.
That liver all goes into Roger's face. It all rolls down that counter. It's all alive.
And all those ducks and everything. And there's that, like, cow, like, that... Yeah. That skinned cow with no head walks in. And
right? They have to fight it?
Yeah, it looks great.
Oh, it's
it
awesome.
Looks legit. Not once do you think, oh, that's fake. That looks crappy. Or,
even though it's like this kind of outlandish thing, it looks real.
It does,
and cool.
Yeah, it looks great. Randy James melts. Like, fucking, like, melts into nothing.
It's so good.
It looks better than a lot of effects today.
It rivals some of it rivals some of the best movies back then.
It does, yeah. Totally does. This movie has a lot of really cool cameos from people that just like, whoa, cool. Like the first one, it knocked me on my ass. Bigelow finds his tape.
It's like, of course, VHS tape.
VHS tape. Like, let's pop it in. Vincent Price is on there.
He's wow.
Like, holy shit. And like, oh man, this, it gives the movie like instant legitimacy.
Master Poe is in this from Kung Fu.
Yeah. And from Star Trek, he's in that that episode of Whom Gods Destroy.
And Sub-Zero is in this from the
Running Man.
Hey, Killian, here's Sub-Zero. Now,
Plane Zero. What does that even mean, Plane Zero? Sub-Zero's already below zero, so wouldn't, like, anything above that be better? I don't know. It's a good story to find out who made this resurrection machine and why it exists and... Mm-hmm. Who's funding it?
It plays very well into the whole rich and poor, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, the rich obviously have the money to not die.
Yeah, which is basically the theme of the movie.
It has a lot of twists in it too, right? Like a lot of the characters in this movie actually die.
The main character of Roger dies in the first 20 minutes. Like, what?
Yeah, so you're like, fuck, that's it for him? But no, not really.
Bring him back. Exactly. And then like you expect like, okay, fucking Bigelow, he's gonna like get his revenge for Roger.
Yep.
And then just find him just dead in that fish tank, hanging upside down. Like, what? Suddenly he's just dead. Like, yeah. I thought he was supposed to be the hero now.
Well, now he's not.
And then you think, okay, well, Randy James, she's the only one left. She's got to be the hero. And she dies too, right? Like, what the fuck? Like, everyone's dying.
Yeah. And actually with Randy, she was dead all along.
Yeah.
Which is cool.
Even though the comedy doesn't always land.
No.
It's not a complete bust with the comedy. There's enough that lands where it's worth it. And it works with the action and the zombies. It just kind of, it's a nice little mesh, right?
Exactly.
And I love though how it plays into the vanity of the 80s. Like,
right?
Like Roger's dead. And they tell him he has 12 hours before he completely fucking decomposes. Gotta make a stop to the drugstore to get makeup to make himself look like he's alive. And then he spends even more time, like, in the shower.
Yeah.
Like, you got, like, a couple of hours. Why are you wasting time showering? And
yeah.
Like,
but nope, he's gotta look good,
yeah,
Bill, right?
It's the 80s. Yeah. So, all in all, I think we're gonna rate this movie...
Treasure.
It's a treasure. At face value, this movie looks like it's gonna be a piece of shit, right? You kind of look at it, look at the cover, dead heat, like, who wants to watch this piece of shit? And we kind of reluctantly watched it, and like, oh man, this is kind of a hidden gem. It is a little treasure.
Exactly.
So,
don't judge a book by its cover, I guess.
So it is a treasure disguised as a trash.
That's right.
And until next time,
keep drinking
and dying
and living again.
And dying again.